This tutorial is of Charmouth in Dorset. In this tutorial I'll try and demonstrate how you create a contrast between the foreground and the background to create a more dynamic painting with lots of light areas and dark areas juxtaposed to each other. So let's get on with it. Well, first of all, we create quite a rough sketch of the area. As you can see, I've just outlined the background, the hills that are dropping down into the sea. And to give that a little bit of scale, I wanted to put a couple of characters in. Characters to the foreground as well, so we've got these two larger characters in the foreground, but just to show that there's a distance between these characters and those boats, I've put some more very small characters next to the boats to show that, just to give the eye the impression that there is quite a distance there. So starting off, I'm using a bit of Prussian blue and a little bit of green as well, just to paint into the sky. I'm using a very nice paper, Clairefontaine, flamboyant range, and it is very, very heavy on the texture. So now I'm just going to be painting around the hills, just to have a bit of sky colour. So now I'm adding water, because I want it darker at the top than it is at the bottom. So towards this part here, I've created quite a bit of water. I'm going to paint downwards now, so let that clean water run and just wash away some of this pigment towards the bottom, so we get a nice transition. There are other ways of doing this, but I just initially I'd put too much pigment on. Perhaps I should have wet the whole lot first and then just painted into it. That would be another way of doing it. But I just chose to do it this way. So I'm adding a little bit more pigment towards the bottom to create that effect. Just leave it like that. Okay, once that is back to its normal position, tips it back the right way, I'm going to mix a very, very light mixture of the same colour that we used on the sky to indicate some dark mountains or hills in the far distance. Don't forget, this will dry a lot lighter, so don't be too frightened to put in a little bit of extra pigment in there. So just to account for its drying out later and its lightening. So now I'm putting some marks indicating the sea. Right up to the characters. I'm using a size 6 brush here. And bring it the sea around the other side. Painting some grass on the top of the second hill, going further back. I'm going to add a bit of water to this just to lighten it out a little bit. I want this hill to be quite light and lighter towards the right than it is the left, because we have the sun shining on that. So just add a little bit of yellow ochre here now as well. You could use a bit of raw sienna if you wanted to. But now I've put that in there. If I add a little bit of water now, it should just blend it out. And it will dry lighter, so I'm happy with that. That strength of colour. There's a bit of green there to hang down. I'm creating soft edges because it is going to be quite a hazy day, so that aerial perspective would allow for that softness. Now this side we have some quite strong coloured trees in the at the top of this hill. So I'm using a mixture of different kind of greens and just adding a little bit of yellow to it as well. And if it looks a little bit too green, just add a touch of burnt sienna to it. It just softens it down a little bit. A bunch of trees standing on its own here at that top part. But just want to indicate the edges of this. There are a couple of little bushes that are just dotted around, pooping over the edge. Just put those in, that's all I really need to do with that. Added a bit of gold green to this. Now bring this down quite loosely. And now again I'll add another colour to it just to add a bit of variety to those colours greens. On the right hand side I want that to be quite light. So I'll add a bit more water to that side when it comes to it. But the trick is to try and keep all this quite wet now. Because as we fetch it down, we're going to add some different cool washes in here, still with a green base. Got some cool washes. Now this part here, you're right, perfectly careful not to go over that line. I want to leave a very, very light, crisp white edge just to indicate the light hitting the side of that hill. Being careful to cut the paint around the edges of these characters. Need to keep this wet. In fact, I want to create a little bead of paint on this here. Let's keep it running. And now I'm just adding some cooler colours to this. And the trick is here is to keep that bead of colour, that bead of watercolour there. Because while that is there, you can still work on it. Once that dries up, That's it. Put your brushes away then. Okay, yeah, so just fetching a dark area of green down to the bottom to separate that, just to indicate the bottom of the hill against the top of the sea. And this here, we're just fetching this dark colour around the boats, around the characters. And this we can just add to this if we want now, if we want to make that warmer, just stick a bit of warmer paint in there. But I'm just indicating around the tops of these boats here. And if it's not dark enough, just add more pigment to it. So you can just make sure you can control how dark this is. Because it is still wet, all the way up to the top, it's still wet. This will create softness. You can add these in, it's not going to be a harsh edge. If you do think that you're going to get a harsh edge, just spray a bit of this, spray a bit of water on first, just to make sure that that doesn't happen. And I know that the paint at the left of this painting has started to dry out a little bit, and I can just see that. But by the way, this is not as soft as I go further on. See there, getting quite it's quite hard, the edge, so I'll use my little spray a bit. So there's a real dark shadow going across that hill. Using a clean brush here now, just to pull that colour down a bit. Soft, nice soft edges. Get my spray bottle now, spray that, and that'll soften that, keep it alive. It takes away the harshness of that edge. Now just neaten it up. With a nice big paintbrush. This is a size 10 brush stroke, by the way. No, it's not. It's a size 16. It's a mop brush. I buy my brushes from a company called Ascoli. You can get them through Jackson's online. Now just spray this here, just at the top of where that shadow is there, and just push it in a little bit. Push, break that harsh line up, and that should just soften. Just squeeze my brush out now, because there'll be some areas where I want to indicate a little bit of lightness. So this part here, there's a path that leads down. So just pulling a bit of that pigment out. That's it, there's a little cafe there. So if I pull that pigment out, that could indicate a little bit of light hitting on the top of that. The road that leads to that cafe. And pull that down. It shows like an angle running down towards the beach. Now I'm using this almost dry, between dry and damp brush, to lift out any beads that are collecting. And the kind of, if you leave the beads without paying attention to these beads, they can run down, or as they dry out, they can just create cauliflowers. Don't want that. These cauliflowers are created by allowing a clean area of water just to dry into a pigmented area. So I don't want that, so I just lift it out. And now I've added a little bit of gold to this green area. Just paint the greenness here of the beach and a little bit of yellow ochre. I'm using the side of the brush to this to allow for little breaks in the colour, which would indicate a wet sand and the little breaks where the sun is highlighting on it. So I use just the side of the brush, just scraping it along, being careful not to make it look as if these are big lines of white. So break those edges up sometimes. Now I like to put a very dark dark area at the bottom of paintings. It just allows for a bit of weight there. Now with my little fan brush, just add in little bits of pigment where this could be grassy area. Just changing the texture. Bringing these little areas of grass around in a way which sculpts the shape of the land. Rather than going straight across, it just indicates that there's a little bit of a hill towards the left by just by fixing this down at this angle. Now the light, bit of pigment, just create and indicate interesting areas on the top of this big hill. Maybe where it has bushes or a little bit of a hedgerow. It takes away from that stark area of green. I'm using a richer pigment now of greens at the top of here just to indicate shadows under these trees. So shadows to the left and underneath. Now I've noticed that some of the pigment that I put on this area is starting to fade back way too light. So just adding that extra amount of pigment on those areas. Just indicate where this little footpath is at the side of this hill. Just only little bits, nothing too drastic, nothing too harsh. Almost like you can't really see it, but it's there when you look close up to it. Now, for the people, I use upper rose, and it's a mixture of upper rose with a cadmium yellow. As I'm putting this on here, it looks quite dark, but it dries lovely, especially if you lift out a little bit of it as well to the side and allow some of the white of the paper to shine through. So just putting the indication of the arms and the faces and the necks, legs. No great detail, because it's quite a loose painting this anyway. just lifting out a little bit of pigment now. Now these boats at the back, I'm making some warm colours to contrast the green, the coolness of the green. So this is quite a rose colour boat here, but I'm leaving a little bit of light at the start, at the front of it, and make it almost shadowy, like a red shadow. But I've got a couple of live those boys on there. So I'm going to leave those to colour those in like an orangey colour in a bit. Just paint carefully into these boats, allowing each layer to dry, increasing bits of pigment, red, maybe a little bit of yellow. Being quite careful with these boats, because they could be part of the main feature of the painting, really, because the eye is being drawn to them. Well, I'm purposely trying to make the eye be drawn to these characters, and they will be in a bit, using light and using lines. Now to put a bit of colour into these characters, I'm going to make her outfit very warm, reddy orange colour. And adding some water towards the right hand there, because that's going to be the lightest area. Left and the bottom is going to be the darkest area, so I'm going to a little bit of Payne's grey in that bottom part, let it run up and create and just do its only work for itself. Now the other character can be much lighter. So I'm using some camp yellow, paint right up to the edge of the left hand side of the character. We don't want any speckles of light coming out there because that would just confuse the eye. Any speckles of light to the right is fine because that could be where the sun's catching, but we don't have it towards the left. Now I'm thinking about some leaving his pants quite white or light coloured. So just add a little bit of grey here just to create a shadow and just to indicate the shape of it. But I'm leaving quite light towards the right, so it looks like it's got, you could have some white trousers on. Increasing the shadows now. Just indicating a bit of hair on the heads before I put in some shadows under the feet. So for this I'm using a little bit of Payne's Grey with the green which is underneath them. I'm feathering this out further back, the further away from then the shadow is, the more it's feathered out. Now I'm putting a shadow around the little cabin on the hill. And a couple of shadows just to indicate where that hill is. Bringing it down. So it looks like there's a rise on that hill. Now putting a little bit of orange in these little boys next to the boats. the same rules of shadow to the left, highlights to the right. So I'm removing some of the pigment with a damp brush, which down from the right hand side, it just gives it a natural highlight. Now, working on the other boats. Painting on the sides of the boats. Once they have dried, I can indicate where shadows are on the inside and on the left hand sides. A bit of blue on this boat. And we're going to indicate a bit of blue on these cabins as well, in a bit. A lighter blue. So putting a hint of blue there, and then we're going to lift it out where the highlight will be. Now I'm going to look at these huts that are like a bluey colour. Now just sharpen these roofs first. Just the back side of it. So you want it a bit darker than this on the left, so I'm going to add a bit of water to the lighter areas, and then go over the shadowed areas with a bit of a darker colour. Paint the mast in now off that boat, just to connect it with the hill. Add to those little characters. just shaping these little boats, you know. These huts. I want this back part of them much darker than they actually are. So, a bit of shadow to the front part, and bring that pigment over. Make this darker, huh? So it's the further away from the light, the darker that is. Add a couple of wicket picket fences, just to give a run up to them. And I think to guide us into the centre of the painting, I think we'll just put a little fence. So we'll have this little fence just showing that we're on a bit of a hill up there, and it's getting smaller as it recedes, so it takes our eye further in. I think I'm going to use my natural hairbrush now, just to add a little bit of looseness to this by just putting a couple of little speckles across the sand and across the grass, and it kind of brings it all together. Just these little points of interest, just to take the eye around the painting. And there's no hard and fast rule of where to put these things. You just, over a period of time, you get used to knowing where they should be. Your eye feels like it should be at a certain place. And put some trees over there just to darken that edge off. This big natural brush, they're great because they're so pliable. You can squash them around and create different shapes with them. I'll give it a dab in there. It won't kill the brush. Put a bit of life in the sky. I don't want to do one directly over the characters. really. But I like to put about 5 birds in there. Then, final part is if we remove the mask. Zoom in. There's a lot of characters, there's a bit of detail there. You see the texture. And this is on the framed piece. Looks. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this tutorial, and I would love to see how you put your painting together as well. Thanks for watching.